Hello, thank you for being here. I was thinking about how to structure my presentation, and I realized that I don't want to sit here and talk, and I don't want you to be there and listen to me. So what I would like to happen is to work more like a team. I was thinking that you'll spend an hour anyway listening to what I'm saying, and maybe you like it, maybe you'll not. So why not to make this hour more useful? Work together, work like a team, try to obtain something. Maybe we'll manage, maybe not. But I like us to try. I was thinking to ask you maybe not to wait until the end of the presentation to ask me questions. Maybe you can ask them as they come. And why so? Because it's possible that waiting until the end of the conversation, not to be in the mood for asking the question. Or you lose momentum, you lose context. So I'd prefer to raise a hand, hey, I have a question, to clarify right away and to move forward, if that's okay with you. All right, so as I said, I would like to work like a team. Think that for an hour we have a common project. And think that at the end of this hour, we need to deliver. What about that? So I'm sorry, it will not be like for you going to a conference and sitting comfortable and attending the speech. It will be more like going to work, doing something, deliver something. Sorry. Okay. What I'd like us to deliver, what would be my list of things? Maybe you'll disagree. First would be saving money, as I promised. But it will not be only that. It will be you being more efficient. It will be you being more aware of what's happening around in your project. It will be you saving time. And it will be you working on most important. How many times did you find yourself working repeatedly at the same thing? Like solving the same goddamn bug. How many times did you find yourself doing the same test, which could be, by the way, automated? Push a button, run the test, go have a beer. How many times? So I'll try maybe to find with you a recipe to do this better, to do this more efficiently, to save you time to work on things that matters, to save you things, work on research, to save you time to just to think about how would you do other things better. And I'll start with a story. Not a happy one, sorry. So, it was almost midnight, and I could hear my phone ringing. Usually, you don't receive good news when the phone is ringing in the middle of the night, and neither did I. It was one of my clients on another part of the globe, for they was middle of the day, and they just tested something that we delivered. Things were not okay. We delivered the feature. By the way, the client was a bank, and they need to be up and running 100% because otherwise they will lose transactions, they will lose money, they will lose clients. And we delivered the new file format, and guess what? We blocked their entire system. So the bank was not able to function. They called me. Hey, we have this problem. It was 12 in the night. What could I do? Reworked changes, gave them the previous version of code, and wait until the morning to talk with the developers to see what we could do. And it was not very good, not in the next day, because why? Because it was only one person who could solve that, and that person was on holiday for 2 weeks. So, no happy end. You imagine what happened. We had to pay a lot of money to the bank for not respecting our SLAs and for not delivering the features we promised time. And at least we learned something out of it. So this is like repeating the conclusions of my story. How many times, because of the time and the money spent on fixing old bugs, you did not have time for developing new features? At least to me, happens frequently in the project. How many times you did not think of adding up the hidden costs, bugs, maintenance, to the initial calculations? When you're thinking about how much a piece of software costs, we're thinking just about how it costs when we are buying it. But it's not like this. Costs a lot to fix bugs. Costs a lot to maintain it. Costs a lot to understand the code so that you can add a new feature. So there are a lot of costs which are not taken into consideration from the first time. And how many times did you realize that the cost of ownership of some software system was unexpectedly higher than the purchase price? Thinking of it, probably most of the times. Let's take the example of an open source code. You are deciding to use it. And what do you think in the beginning? It's open source. It's not costing. No. It costs. Costs to understand the design, cost to add a new feature, cost to fix bugs, cost to test it, and so on. To my deliverables in this presentation, discussed how to measure the cost of owning a software application and how to decrease this cost as much as possible. As I told you in the beginning, it's not only about the cost. It's about your time, it's about being able to work on something that really matters. It's about you being able to innovate instead of repeating tests and bugs and fixing the same goddamn things over and over. I don't think that someone in this room disagreeing to what I'm saying. At least me had lots of times frustrating over doing the same thing. And the same thing doesn't matter that I'm fixing a bug or repeating something. Even in the role of Scrum Master or Project Manager, you are doing the same things, explaining to the sales that this is not working again. Discussing about, okay, didn't we talk about fixing the bugs 2 months ago? Yes, we did. Stuff like that. Okay, so measuring how much a software application costs. All the costs from purchase to disposal have to be summed up. All the costs. I'll give you some examples. Maybe you'll be able to add some other examples to my examples. For instance, I gave that example with open source cost. Open source code cost. I think seriously that before taking the decision of using an open source cost, you have to evaluate the design. You have to test it at least minimal. You have to think how would you use it? You have to think, how would you extend it? You have to think in terms of the number of years you want to use it, what you want to do, and add all these costs. I'm taking this example because it's the most extreme one. Most of the people will say that open source is free. What the heck, let's use it. No. By the way, nothing is free. You know that, right? Okay. Maybe someone in the room wants to give an example, wants to share something about using a piece of code and realizing later on that piece of code costed way more than expected. Do you have this kind of example? You know, don't think you don't need to think about money. You need to think about you being frustrated over a piece of code. You thinking that that was crap and the decision to use it was not good. Any examples? Yep. Do we have a microphone?
Okay, it was in the middle of the 90s, and I started to work in the company where the one of the financial application which were used were written by the one programmer, by the on the platform, which is open source platform, and it starts works. We work at approximately half a year, and after we considered that a part of the data begins to lose somewhere, we didn't understand. We just consider it, find the way, and understand. We make a lot of, and after we request, of course, to repair this bug. It was repaired, but we spent, I don't remember, approximately six people has worked 2 weeks, 14 days, working days, all the day, nights, to enter all the data, to find it and to enter all the data. So in this case, of course, the development was cheap, but as a result, if we will calculate how much we spent for that and what was the cost of the workforce, it will not be so cheap as a result.
Yep, thank you.
You're welcome.
Do you have another example in the room? I just want to add two more things and we'll go further with the presentation. Even if people will spend like 5 days to fix a bug, it may cost you a developer leaving from the team. It may cost you a developer being demotivated and not be doing his or her job as best as he or she can. It can cost you a lot of things, not only money. That's what I wanted to say. It can cost you like rewriting the code at some point. That will be money, translated in time of rewriting it, developers, testing it, SQEs, and another things which will be wasted. Now, what's my magic wand? How do I want to fix it? You know, this is not entirely true. Scrum can help a lot, but there is no magic wand. Depends on project. You may want to apply something or apply something else. I want to be completely fair on this. Scrum will make things visible, will make them easier, will help you structure them. So if I would recommend it, yes, all the times. This is why I put it on the slides in presenting it. But depends on project to project, it may be something else that will do a difference. Maybe a design decision. Maybe you'll need to evaluate the software first. Maybe a testing decision. Maybe a POC, proof of concept, of what you want to do using that software you want to buy or adopt. So it may not be only Scrum. So something else may do a lot of difference. So what I want to emphasize here is pay attention, think about what you want to obtain, think about how you want to validate it better, and do that thing. If your project manager or the business owner will not agree, find arguments to convince them. It will be quite obvious later that the decision to do so was a good one. So, how Scrum will help us? Less time, and therefore money, spent on understanding the existing code. What do I say here? Refactor all the time the existing code. how you'll say, how do I do this? Because I usually don't have time to refactor everything. People will, in my project, will scream if they will hear that I want to refactor things. Well, one idea would be to include it in the definition of done. You have a definition of done, and you state in there clearly what needs to be done so that that iteration to be finished. Include the refactoring. Now, maybe you'll ask yourself, what does she want to say by refactoring? I'm not saying by refactoring all the code all the time. No. Would it make sense? Like, keep in mind that a quality standard of the code, you want to make the code as simple as possible, as understandable as possible. Like, if you are a developer in the project and I'll come and tell you, okay, how does your code look like? To be able to draw a diagram all the time. That, from my point of view, would be one measure of hygiene of the code. If you are able all the time to draw a diagram for it and explain it, that's okay. If you are not, maybe you want to think again. When adding a new feature, if the code remains clear, as I said before, you will be able to explain it with a simple diagram, that would be still okay. If by adding that feature, things are becoming more complex, maybe unnecessarily complex, maybe you will want to do that redesign I'm talking about. Of course, this is not mandatory. You'll have it in the definition of done, and you'll do it if it will make sense. Spend less money on adapting the existing code. When you are working with Scrum, you will work only on the most important features. Remember, you have a product owner is prioritizing the things, and you will work on the ones on the top of the list. Therefore, the product will be like, maybe I'm exaggerating, but more or less that 20% that will assure you the 80% of revenue from the market. Not less, not more. Does it make sense? I saw a lot of products which were unnecessarily complex. Like, doing this and that and that. And does it do this? Yes, of course. And does it do that? Not yet, but it will have this feature added by, I don't know, the end of the next sprint. Sometimes it doesn't make sense. Sometimes that added complexity will not pay the money. So the idea is to keep the code as tiny as possible and to do the most of the features that actually make the product important. Scrum will help you with this. And for developing and testing how this will help you to work on less complex code. It will be easy to maintain, easy to handle, easy to everything. Also, what's important? It's important to prioritize first the bugs. That's one important thing I almost forgot to talk about, and I think that it makes a difference. So when in your sprint we'll have 5 bugs and 5 features, and you will not be able to commit on all of them, my advice would be to prioritize the bugs who are making sense. Maybe it will be a decision in your team to live with the bug. Not important, leave it. That's okay as well. But at least to be aware that you made that decision, not ignore the bug. Just think about it, see what's your decision about it, do it or not do it. And it's better to fix the bugs sooner than later. I remember some conversations with the sales team. Hey, we are not able to talk with the clients about the new features because we are explaining them over and over that we are not able to fix that bug, and that bug again, and that bug again. So I think that's less costly to fix the bugs first, because the way the team feels about their product will improve. They will be prouder of what they are doing, working on a non-buggy product. The discussions with other departments in the team will improve, because you will not spend the same time and again explaining them why you are not able to fix the bugs. And also, the way clients are perceiving the product, and therefore the team will improve as well. Going further, decrease total cost of ownership by having automated tests. Why do I put this on the slide as being very important? Because they will save you a lot of time and a lot of money. It will be an investment implementing them once. Probably you all know this thing. I'm not sure if you are having time or being able to impose this to be done in your project. How many of you are having automated tests, as in for the whole project, not doing manually, maybe only exploratory? So not so many people, unfortunately. Talking about automated tests, because we have time, how I did it in my project? I did it in three steps. First time, only the hygiene tests, like only the tests which are telling me if the project is working or not. And this is enough to understand if you broke something very, very critical. Next level of tests will be like testing all the major features, and the next level will be test everything. I've had projects in which the automated tests were run like for 20 hours. But in the end, I knew that I could ship the product in production without doing anything else. Everything was automated. Running the tests, if all green, put the kit on update, and the kit was being used by the client. That was awesome. Save money by focusing on quality. What do you think that I mean by quality? Can you tell me a few words? One word for quality, one word that comes first to your mind. Number of bugs. Meeting requirements. Please.
Value.
Yep. Something else?
Definition of done.
Yep, but this is quite large. This can include everything that comes to our mind, that's quality.
Client satisfied.
Yep. Something else?
Stability.
Yep. Something else?
Money.
In the end, this is how we measure it. Are we able to make money with the product? Are we able to sell it? Otherwise, things will not happen. When I'm talking about quality, I'm thinking about other things as well, like code reviews. I'm curious, how important do you think that are code reviews? Hands up if you think that they are important. Yeah, about 75% of the people. And two hands behind. I'll tell you that projects in which I had the most quality of code were projects where code reviews were done like without exception and with some rules that we agreed in the team and applied all the time. For instance, no piece of code, not even something that is really simple, it will not enter into master without 2 thumbs up. So you have to have, of course, if the team is bigger than 4, you have to have in my normal size teams at least 2 colleagues which will tell you, I like this and this can go into master. Otherwise, the code will not go into master. May sound too hard, but I'm telling you, this assured a awesome quality of the code. The rules were like that, actually. Thumbs down. If a thumbs down appeared, the code will not go into master, no matter what. It will be 0, like, I don't care, but I don't necessarily recommend that code to go into master. And thumbs up, I love it, I want to see it into master. And when this happened, when I had these rules into the project, it happened very, very rarely to not at all to have the master spoiled, to have any major automated test failing, and so on. Because people were paying attention to the code. Other thing that worked, I'm just trying to share what worked in my project. Other thing that worked, it was peer reviews. When something was challenging and it was not easy to think about it by yourself, you are asking a colleague to sit together with you at the computer, work with you, thinking about the code, thinking about how to write it, think about design and so on. So that was something else that worked. Highlighting again a very good battery of automated tests. I don't think that makes sense to test anything manually, because you'll test it over and over, and even if you think that at the beginning the automated tests are costing a lot, this is not like that, because if you are adding all the cost of manually testing something, will be probably more. The relation between these things I talked about, thought of cost ownership, quality, time, and money, is like this. They are depending on each other all the time. If you keep this scheme in mind when thinking about a project, you will be able to see each of them and highlight them accordingly. Now I have 2 questions for you. Which costs are more important for your project in influencing overall total cost of ownership results? Can you give me some examples? So when you think about your project, right now, the current project, I don't want to imagine anything. I don't want you to invent anything. I want you to think about what you are doing now and think about the cost. It's about the cost of repeatedly testing something. It's about the cost of solving bugs over bugs. What is it about? Any examples? Yep. And besides the tests, what kind of other manuals are you thinking about?
For example, some requests from business or other stakeholders that something should be done, but it seems like a small thing and it keeps being done repeatedly, and actually it could be automated, so it's a lot of costs and it takes away from development time.
Yeah, big time, thumb up. Like, for instance, adding something in a database, right? Adding a new client or adding a feature which you know how to do and you would not do it manually. More, or I'm thinking about the cost of provisioning. Provisioning when I'm saying provisioning when thinking about adding a new client. Like you need to configure the client in the system, you need to add him in the database, you need to add maybe a table for him, you need maybe to put some ideas of that client in the project and so on, right? And you'd rather do like an admin button for the product owner to add it there since the beginning instead of having the product owner coming to the development team and ask you all the time to do that.
Yes, or for example, making reports from systems which are not reporting systems.
Yep. I remember that in one project, to your point, I automated also the classification of the bugs. So I had this project, it was crashing a lot. We were submitting by that time, like 10 years ago, all the dumps to Microsoft. And at some point, Microsoft came and said, hey guys, we don't have servers for how many dumps you have. So do something about them. We don't want to host them anymore. All our space for saving the dumps, it's yours now. And we are not very happy about this. And we were like, oops. We redirected the bugs to our servers, and because they were on our servers, we were able to understand how many times the product is crashing. And it was a lot. It was like a shock to us. And what did we do? Because we had like thousands of crash dumps. And I don't know how many of you did you developed in C++. You have a dump and you have a stack, and the stack is telling you some important steps used by the program until it crashed. And we did something like a very simple AI which classified those stacks so that to put the dumps into category and to able to solve them with priorities. And we automated this. Basically, all the dumps were going through this AI, were classified in one of the clusters, and we counted the number of bugs for each cluster, and we solved them with priority so that would be efficient. In 2 months, we did not have any dump, but it was like crazy. But to my point, it was quite good that we automated. Other examples of costs which are most important for a project. Someone else? I'm sure that you have examples. I just don't think that you are telling them out loud, but I'm sure that all of you have examples. Otherwise, please come here and share us the recipe of having a project which is not costly at all. So, do you have another example worth of mentioning?
Well,
thank you.
My colleague just discussed. So we are usually kind of stuck with really development of new features, big features, not the small one, but the big one, where you can't really tell at the very beginning. Define the scope of the work, and this is why you can't really define costs to be precise. So it user story ends up like an epic.
Okay. And what do you do? How do you do to be able to influence positively the cost on doing that?
Well, it came down to just having multiple sessions of grooming before starting to work on a story. So
maybe some design, maybe some proof of concepts done to understand how much will take to implement some of the things in there.
Yeah, it depends on the story. Sometimes we do journey mapping, sometimes we do prototype. So it really depends.
Yeah, but you're right. This is painful sometimes, not understanding how much it'll cost. Other example? I don't want to pick someone randomly. Yep. We have someone here. And I think that we have someone over there. No?
Well, we kind of have like a product that is very complex with lots of lines of code, and it's very big. Lots of people work on it. And usually, well, in Agile, we spend a lot of time on planning meetings, on refinements and stuff like that. And it takes a lot of energy, takes a lot of time, and you have to prepare for those meetings. You have to after then go around, and it sometimes takes a lot of time from the sprint. And the time to work actually on it stays quite less.
And how do you do it? I'm trying, if I'm having like an example or a question, I'm trying to find together an answer.
How do we do meetings?
No. How would you change that so that not to cost so much? Just curious. I mean, you stated the problem, and I was curious if you have a solution or not.
I don't have a solution.
I'm wondering if the meetings are helping you. Actually, without them, things will be more unorganized, and you'll not be able actually to do more. Or they are actually costly, because if they are only costly but they are actually helping you, and without them would be worse, it's money invested. If you think that you can improve them so that to be more efficient, that would be another thing. So maybe I don't know how are the meetings in your project. Maybe make them shorter if possible. Maybe structure them better. I'm curious if you have a retrospective meeting. And I assume that you are giving feedback and that feedback is implemented. So maybe there would be a good spot to think about improvements. You know about improvements. Maybe some will work, maybe some will not. My advice is to try them, see what it works, dump what is not. Another example of cost in your project. Yep.
In our teams, we have very skill-based positions. So basically, the issue is that there isn't a developer, and there isn't a tester, and there is an auto QA, and that's a struggle. But we are trying to integrate the positions to see can they be somehow, well, can the people be trained to also, in some case of absence, to manage the other.
That's a great
positions.
Point, actually. That's a great point. I saw a lot of projects wasting time, not having the same the whole set of skills needed for the project in the same team. So cost is added by. Cost is added by spending time to talk between different teams and maybe to argue about how things should be done, maybe to book meetings because that team is not available when you need it, maybe spend time and therefore money waiting for them to become available. Yep, that's a great point. Thank you. So here the recommendation would be to have all the skills needed for one project in one team. I know that sometimes it's hard. I know for some companies this is not an option because someone above there thinks that's important to have different teams doing different things and separated. But as recommended also by Scrum, but I can recommend it based on experience. I would say that it's best to have all the skills needed in the same team. People will be available right away when they are needed. People will know what's happening in the project. People will have stand-ups daily and they will know about each other and so on. So the communication part is awesome.
Team and the designer team is somewhere outside of another department, but the issue that I'm mentioning is that, for instance, in the team there is developers, QAs, auto QAs, Scrum Master, and basically if the developer is off,
Yeah, for instance, the testers are off. The developers are saying, "Well, I'm actual developer, so I."
So basically, your advice would to have backups between the positions so that they can. You will have backup when they'll be on holidays or when they become unavailable for one reason or another, right? Yep, that too. Also, Scrum will, I think that will help you with that too, because you have a backlog and you have a list of priorities and everyone will work on that list of priorities. So if on the top it's testing and testing and testing, probably everyone will need to take that testing task, learn how to work on it and deliver it. I'm not sure again if this is applicable in all the projects in mind, is applicable. This is how people are usually working. But maybe to your point, thank you again. It may be strange for a developer to work on QE tasks, or maybe strange for a QE to work on development tasks, but this is not normal. People should do everything that needs to be done in a project as much as they are capable of, if not learn. To the other point of having skills in different parts of the companies, avoid this as much as possible. I'm aware that the design team may be a separated design team. If possible, take the designer, drag him or her in your project, keep it there until the project is done. Same with the deployment. I'll give you an example of one situation that I have in my project. We were doing monthly deployment in production, and the deployments were usually a big event in the sense that guy doing the deployment needed like all the developers around him to do the deployment. So in that day, we did not do anything else. All the team was doing deployment, buying pizza, preparing for the big event of deployment, and in the end, usually we had problems. And at some point, after negotiations with the management, I put the guy doing the deployment in my team. And he was actually working on some automation for deployment, like CI/CD stack. And for each deployment, for each change in the code, merging to master, basically his automated tool was doing a deployment in an environment which was production-like. And since then, the big event of doing deployments in my team disappeared. Everybody was very sad. No, I'm joking. Everyone was very happy. So that was another cost added, because we spent like the time of the whole team. Basically, people paid for one day doing something that could be automated. And we did it like this in the end. So that's another example. Basically, we answer to the second point while giving the examples. But if you have other examples that you think that's worth discussing them, I'm happy to hear them.
From my experience, there is a usual thing when teams started to invent some tool prior to having a process. So we have a trouble, and someone came up and thinks, let's buy this tool, and this tool will help us to solve this trouble. Mm-hmm. But most of the time, the result is the trouble is as is, and we have some tool and some money and time invested in it, but never using it. And I recommend to always use plain, simple things to start up your process, to have it working, and only after that, when you have some working process, you start to thinking, which tool could help me to automate this? And never start with a tool.
I totally agree. And if possible, depends on the skills in the team, maybe develop it yourself, because it will be adapted exactly on what you need, right? Thank you. Do we have another example? Maybe I should have put that on the board sooner. Okay. Thank you so much for this session. I really enjoyed it. Thank you for working like a team for an hour. And if you have questions or suggestions or comments about the session or any kind of comments, write an email to me. Thanks a lot.